Thank you. Actually, I gave my clubs to my son, and he's been living in Riverside for the last 2 years. Garrett. Thank you.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
We want to welcome each and every one of you to our worship service here at Madison campus. And to our visitors, we're so
happy that you've chosen to come and visit and worship with us this morning. And our internet viewers, you're tuning in, and we hope that you receive a rich spiritual blessing from having turned in to our worship service this morning. There will, just a note of reminder, there is no fellowship lunch today. So you church members, you look around, and if you see a visitor that has a distressed look on their face right now, invite them home for lunch. And the Lord will multiply your food, as we know He can do. In the pews in front of you, there are prayer cards. We are a praying church, and a church that prays together is a strong, united church. And so if you have a burden, if you'll get one of those cards and put it down, whether it be a health concern, maybe it's a financial situation, maybe it's a job situation, we want to pray for you and pray with you because mighty things happen when we pray. We're so glad that you came this morning. We want you to sit back and enjoy a peaceful worship time with the Prince of Peace, Christ Jesus.
Good morning, church family. It's a blessing to be with you this morning. Welcome and happy Sabbath. You know, our world seems to be moving at lightning light speed. Sometimes information travels across the world in a matter of seconds. Our lives get so busy and hectic. But it's good to realize that we have an opportunity to come and find that quiet place where we can be with God and just rest in His presence. As we worship together this morning, we invite you to sing with us our call to worship, Quiet Place.
Where God can soothe my trouble. Our offering this morning is for North American Division Women's Ministries. And as many of you know, this is a ministry that is near and dear to my heart. I have worked in the Kentucky-Tennessee Conference Women's Ministries Department now for over 10 years. So I have seen firsthand how this ministry touches the lives of women in our conference, and this ministry goes throughout the world. So I hope that each one of you this morning will give generously and know that every dollar that you give goes to minister to women and for women to learn to minister to those around them in their church as well. Will our deacons please come forward? Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this Sabbath day, for another day of life, all that you have blessed us with. Lord, I ask that you be with each person here, with their gift as they give it to further your work. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and your love. We pray that you come back soon. In your name, amen.
As the deacons collect the offering, we invite you to sing with us in our song segment. God's love for us is deeper than we can imagine. His mystery, salvation, giving us salvation on the cross is what we are here for today. I invite you to sing with us, The Wondrous Cross.
Glory died.
How deep the Father's love for us.
My wife and I live next door to three precious ladies. And two of them are sisters, and the other is a lifelong friend. They're all retired. One of the sisters is a Baptist. The other sister and the other lady is a Church of Christ. From time to time, these ladies ask me to come over and do something for them, because they know I enjoy doing that. From time to time, they ask me questions about my religion, because they watch and they know what's going on. The Baptist lady especially is interested in Seventh-day Adventist. She will ask me, "Do you believe in baptism by immersion?" I say, "Yes, of course." "Do you have communion at your church?" "Yes, we have communion." "Do you have foot washing?" "Yes, we do." Every time there's little questions, and in my heart I'm smiling. I can help them out, and they're curious about us as Seventh-day Adventists. Today, as we celebrate communion service, I am so proud to be a part of this church. My wife and I went to First Weekend at GC, and to see the vast number of people there and the number of countries represented, we're truly a blessed church. This morning, as we kneel and pray, I want you to pray in your heart also for those that you have special concerns for, and we all have those concerns. Let's kneel together. Father in heaven, what a privilege it is for us to be in your house today. We thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day, your blessings to us for life and health, and the things that we enjoy. We thank you for being a part of this church, this remnant church. Father, we believe we're living in the last days. We thank you that we can be a part of it. Help us to be fully dedicated and faithful to you to the very end. As we have our communion service today, we think about Jesus. We think about his sacrifice on the cross, his shed blood for us, his broken body. And we thank you for that, because without that, there would be no hope, without his death and resurrection. We thank you for the way you've led us in the past as a church, and we know what the future holds, and it brings peace to our heart that we know that you're in control. Father, we thank you for our World Church, our General Conference session that will end today, tonight. We thank you for being a part of a world organization and seeing the many different people that believe the same way as we do. 18.5 million people, more than 160 countries represented there. We thank you for the decisions that have been made. We thank you today that we can come to you as our Savior and pray to you, knowing that you will answer our prayers. Father, each of us have concerns on our hearts, and just now, as we mention those names to you, we thank you for the privilege of prayer and answered prayer. We have names on our church bulletin insert, Father, that we want to remember. Under cancer treatment, we have John Morgan, Ray Pledger, Paul Shearer, Sharon Dullesong, Frida Huffman, Nancy Martin, Louise Hoover, and Melinda Hill. We continue to remember the Cheeks family, Care Fay dealing with ALS. We remember Lois Hubbard under hospice care, Walter Hill with health issues, Melody and Bob Steele and family, Melody's mom, Jerry Hammock, passed away. Father, we've all lost loved ones, and we know the emptiness, we know the pain, but we also know the peace that comes from knowing you, and knowing that if we're faithful to you, we will see these loved ones again. Be with us today as we have our communion service. Please be in our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Be with Elder Beats as he leads out and brings us your word. Help us to do your will, represent you, and be ready when you come, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
I also just came back from the General Conference session being held in San Antonio. Preceding that, there was a ministers' meeting, actually, in Texas also, that included about 400 ministers, 400 or 500 ministers from the North American Division, which was a very inspirational event. A few observations simply about the World Church and our participation in the World Church that might be of interest as we begin our service today. As was mentioned in the prayer, we have a very international church. The secretary of the General Conference made an observation that statistically, it looked like 8% of the world church was located in what would be considered the north or the northern part of the world. That would include Europe, the United States, Canada, Japan, Korea, I suppose, Russia, the northern sections of the world, and that 92% of the population of the world church was located in the south, which we might consider Africa, South America, Inter-America, India, and that portion of the world. So our missionary activity has been exceedingly effective. The church began here in the United States and has truly spread worldwide to nearly 20 million people at this point. Historically, the North American division, or Canada and the United States, and now actually Guam and Micronesia, are those that have funded the activities of the General Conference. So most of the resources for the General Conference have historically come from the United States. But today, 50% of the funding of the General Conference comes from these other countries. And so it is continually becoming more of a balanced, in many ways, international church. It is a challenge to hold such a church together as one. I know the last time I preached, I talked about the importance of fulfilling the prayer of Jesus, that we all be one. Imagine how difficult, that's tough enough in your own family, and then tough enough in your own church. But imagine an international church where the vast differences in culture, in experience, in background, portray themselves in various church activities. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is really the only Protestant, worldwide, cohesive church. I mean, you have Baptists and other evangelicals that are spread all over the world, but few of them have the kind of organization that we have. They have international churches. We have an international church. They have national churches. So you'd say you'd have the Church of the Baptist maybe in Russia and or in South America or in Africa or in different places. But our church is very cohesive worldwide. And there are some concerns about spending the amount of money that we do on this meeting, which is $20 to $30 million that we held this last 9 days. But if you're going to have an international family, you simply have to get together now and then. And when you calculate the amount that we're spent on this meeting as compared to the total of tithe that comes from all over the world in the billions of dollars, it's really a small amount to pay to pull people together, to make decisions together, and to process what it means to be an international church. So we truly have, I think, a great experience, a great opportunity to participate in such a impressive organization. Let's bow briefly before we begin our sermon. Dear Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to serve you. We'd ask your blessing as we reflect today on the incarnation. For Jesus' sake, amen. 1 Corinthians 13:12. Now we see but a poor reflection. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. In the King James Version, it says, now we see through a glass darkly. Glass was not invented until late Roman times. And so the mirror or reflection that Paul is talking about was probably a shiny piece of brass or something like that, not anything comparable to what we might have as a glass mirror today. And Paul is suggesting that just a poor reflection that we see now, that really we don't grasp what the reality and the truth is. In 1 Corinthians 13:12, in the mission, in the message paraphrase, and I enjoy reading the paraphrase now and then, we don't yet see things clearly. We're squinting in a fog, peering through a mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then, see it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing Him directly, just as He knows us. We don't see things clearly, like through a fog. Have you ever been driving through an incredibly heavy rainstorm and you're leaning up onto your steering wheel and the windshield wipers are going fast and you're trying to make sure you're seeing what everybody else is seeing, or at least that you're seeing the road that you're on? We don't see things clearly now. It's like looking through a mist. I remember when I was a student in Michigan at Andrews University, and in a heavy snowstorm driving, I couldn't tell where the road was. I could only tell where the road wasn't when I started going off the road. And then I would steer back the other direction to get back on the road. Not being able to see clearly. And when we think about our experience of God and our experience of religion and our experience of spirituality and our experience of Jesus, we see through a glass darkly. It's not crystal clear. We only get a brief taste in reality, a small portion. Many Christians have so busied themselves with programs and activities that they no longer know how to be silent and meditate on God's Word or recognize the mysteries that are in the person of Christ. So busy thinking maybe that we know it all, and so busy with our activities that not taking time to stop and think about what does it mean to be connected to the God of the universe. Like a blind man reaching out to touch an elephant and experiencing different things to gain a picture of the whole elephant. I'm sure you've all heard this poem before, but I'd like to read it again because it is so appropriate in terms of our understanding, in terms of what we perceive. It's called The Blind Men and the Elephant by John Sachs. It was six men of Hindustan, to learning much inclined, who went to see the elephant, though all of them were blind, that each by observation might satisfy the mind. The first approached the elephant and happened to fall against his broad and sturdy side, at once began to brawl. Bless me, it seems the elephant is very like a wall. The second, feeling of his tusk, cried, ho, what have we here? So very round and sharp and smooth, to me 'tis mighty clear, this wonder of an elephant is very like a spear. The third approached the animal, and happening to take the squirming trunk within his hands, then boldly up and spake, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a snake. The fourth reached out an eager hand and felt about the knee. What most this wondrous beast is like is mighty plain, quoth he. 'Tis clear enough the elephant is very like a tree. The fifth, who chanced to touch the ear, said, even the blindest man can tell what this resembles most. Deny the fact who can. This marvel of an elephant is very like a fan. The sixth no sooner had begun about the beast to grope than seizing on the swinging tail that fell within his scope, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a rope. And so these men of Hindustan disputed loud and long, each in his own opinion exceeding stiff and strong, though each was partly in the right and all were in the wrong. So oft in theologic wars, the disputants, I ween, rail on in utter ignorance of what each other mean, and prate about an elephant not one of them has seen. As again I think about the diverse circumstances in which our individual church members around the world have grown up, all of us seeing through a glass darkly, seeing things different, like astronomers peering at a few photons of light that have come a trillion miles away, seeking to discover the nature of the universe, the physicist peering at the computer screen that shows a few things that are left after the collision of fundamental forces, and trying to figure out what the fundamental rules of the universe are, we really have only scratched the surface. Scratched the surface when we think about and seek to understand and know God. Now, when you talk about mystery and you talk about the communion service, the first thing that might come to your mind is the Catholic approach to the communion, which is that the bread and the wine actually become the body and the blood of Christ. Now, of course, the Seventh-day Adventist Church believes that these are symbols and does not actually become that, but then that mystery is still there. But that's not the kind of mystery I'm thinking about. We can see and understand only a little about God now, only a little, as if we were peering through a glass darkly. Amos Alcott said, "To be ignorant of one's ignorance is the malady of the ignorant." Read that again. To be ignorant of one's ignorance is the malady of the ignorant. Not understanding and knowing that you don't understand is the problem. But appreciating the fact that there is a mystery, that we don't fully understand, and that we are therefore humble in the presence of others and certainly in the presence of God. Humble that we don't fully grasp everything there is to grasp. The first step in gaining wisdom is to recognize what we don't know. And there's so much that we don't know. And there's so much confidence sometimes that our eager ego can claim that we know. We should be humble and give way to the fact that we see through a glass darkly. The reflection of reality in our personal mirrors are imperfect at best and simply wrong at worst. Think about it. We think with our hands on the Bible, we know so much more than many other people about the Bible, and that certainly is true. There's a great deal of Bible ignorance in the world today. I was going to a door to give a Bible study to a lady once, and I said, "Well, you know, I was talking about, Noah and the flood," and she said, "Who and what?" You know, we kind of assume sometimes of fundamental Christian knowledge of Bible stories that simply doesn't exist in our world today. So we think we have a great deal of understanding, and certainly we have more than many people around us. But at the end of the day, we stand before a great mystery: God becoming man, God becoming human. I don't offer any answers today about the mystery of God. I ask, what do we really know about God? Most of us think in terms of anthropomorphic visions, which basically means we think of God like we think of a real, strong, powerful person, a human being. And of course, Jesus is God, and he became a human being. But as we think about God before he became a human being, what do we think about? What do we visualize? It's very difficult. What can a dog think about his master's purposes? What can a bird know about the nature of life? What does a cat understand about her master's goals and objectives? We really think too highly of ourselves and the truth that we possess. We may have a good grasp on some eternal principles that allow us to grasp, at least through this mirror, the fact that God has come to earth and is giving us eternal life. But we stand, when it comes to understanding and appreciating God, we stand on the edge of the Grand Canyon trying to fish in the Colorado River. It's so far and way different than we are. The mystery is beyond our comprehension. And the communion service itself brings us to that mystery. It confronts us with the reality of the incarnation, that we don't understand, but we stand in awe of God, our Creator, becoming human. While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, gave a prayer of thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. "Take and eat it," he said. "This is my body." Then he took the cup and gave thanks to God and gave it to them. Drink it, all of you, he said, for this is my blood which seals God's covenant, my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. How does that work? How do we know that? Do we understand the mystery of the incarnation? Do we understand the science of salvation? Do we grasp, this is my body, this is my blood? There are such incredible mysteries that we are confronted with when we think about, when we seek to grasp God, we are looking through a glass very darkly. Job 11:7-9, can you fathom the mysteries of God? Can you probe the limits of the Almighty? They are higher than the heavens. What can you do? They are deeper than the depths of the grave. What can you know? Their measure is longer than the earth and wider than the sea. What can we know when it comes to probing the mysteries of God? Ecclesiastes 11:5, just as you'll never understand the mystery of life forming in a pregnant woman, so you'll never understand the mystery at work in all that God does. Or Paul in Romans, oh, the depths of riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Yes, there's much we don't understand. There's much that is mystery. But you know the nice thing? There are some things we do know, and that is what we focus on today. Not what we don't know, but what we do know. 1 Timothy 3:16. This Christian life is a great mystery, Paul says, far exceeding our understanding, but some things are clear enough. He appeared in a human body, was proved right by the invisible spirit, was seen by angels, he was proclaimed among all kinds of people, believed in all over the world, and taken up into heavenly glory. That much we know, because Paul testifies to it, as does the New Testament. And so as we face the bread and the wine, the sacraments of the body and blood of Christ, we are brought face to face with the fact that we don't understand all that's going on here, but there are some things we can be certain of. The incarnation. God became flesh, died, was resurrected, and will return to take us to our heavenly home. That we can have confidence in, and that we have surety when. We can argue from now to eternity, and probably will, about the nature of Christ, about the relationship between faith and works, about the sanctuary in heaven, about how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, even about the ordination of women. But that's pretty minor game we play in the presence of the mystery of God. Anne Lamont said, I do not at all understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are, but does not leave us where it found us. We don't understand it. It doesn't leave us where we are, but moves us on. We are pygmies in the forest of truth, and at communion we should recognize and celebrate the mystery of it all and accept it. Fortunately, you don't have to understand a radio to play it. You don't need to understand the workings of a car to drive it. And you don't need to understand God to worship. In fact, because we don't understand, we worship. Because if we did understand everything, we'd worship each other. And we wouldn't be worshiping God. Because we are confronted with the mystery of the incarnation. We're all blind to some extent. We're all looking at this elephant in different ways. And we run into this God in different ways, and we have different experiences. But we do have one experience, and that is the experience of grace, that God accepts us and he became flesh on our behalf. Let us be committed to what we know. In the incarnation, God became flesh, died and was resurrected, and will return again to take us to our heavenly home. And may that come soon. We'll now dismiss for the ordinance of humility, which is a time of preparation, of introspection, of thoughtfulness, where we reflect on our own lives and where we, in many ways, it's a miniature baptism, where we wash feet and we become clean again as we accept the Lord's grace. And those participating as families will go down the hall to the end of the hall, where they will participate in the ordinance of humility in the fellowship hall, and the women will go in that direction as well, and the men have a room set aside for them that you'll notice on your way down the hall as well. Let us separate now for the ordinance of humility.
Washed me in your cleansing flow.
if you'd like.
Story of that hymn and how this gentleman lost his family in a fire and then, no, in a boat accident, I guess, as they were going to England. And on his way back, as he passed that spot where he lost all his children, he was able to write that song. It's a moving message. 1 Timothy 3:16, the Christian life is a great mystery, far from exceeding our understanding, far exceeding our understanding, but some things are clear enough. He appeared in a human body, was proved right by the invisible spirit, was seen by angels, he was proclaimed among all kinds of peoples, believed in all over the world, and taken up into heavenly glory. And of course, we look for that ourselves, to be taken up into heavenly glory. And it is because of the incarnation that that happens, and the mystery of the incarnation we celebrate, reflect on today. We will read the scripture blessing the bread. We'll pass out the bread and the wine, and then we'll read the scripture on the wine, have a prayer, and then participate in taking the body and blood of Christ.
Reading Paul's words as he says them here in 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." The elders will kneel. Father, we wish to thank you so much for what you have done for us. Lord, you sent the whole treasure of heaven when you sent your Son to redeem fallen man. And we, Lord, though so unworthy, are so grateful for what you have done for us. Father, as we partake of this emblem today, we realize that it's not truly the flesh and blood, but that it is representative of the bread of life, of the word that you have given to us, of your Son. Lord, we ask that you will bless this. Help us to turn closer to you. Help us to reflect your Son to those around us, that we may be all one with you as he is one with you. For Christ's sake, we ask and pray. Amen.
Well, these are already broken.
Thank you.
1 Corinthians 11, verse 25 says, "In the same manner he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" The elders will kneel for prayer. Loving Lord, as we partake of this symbol this morning of the spilt blood that was spilt at Calvary, so each one of us may have eternal life with you, may we realize the awesomeness of the sacrifice. May we realize the awesomeness of your love and your grace. We don't have to understand the mystery. We just have to be thankful and believe. And we praise your name. May this symbol, as we partake of it this morning, change our hearts and change our lives for eternity. In thy dear precious name, amen.
While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, gave a prayer of thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. "Take and eat it," he said. "This is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks to God, and gave it to them. "Drink it, all of you," he said, "for this is my blood, which seals God's covenant, my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins."
Just the first verse. Garden of Gethsemane. As you leave the sanctuary today, there will be deacons at the doors to receive an offering for the poor. May we all remember that today we have experienced anew the mystery of God, and that we have enshrined that incarnation in our experience and in our own life.